Welcome back. So, we're going to continue playing some correspondence chess. I've received a few notifications that, hey, it's my turn. So, let's play my turn. We're playing 13 games at once. Here's 12 of the 13. There's the 13th. And now it's searching for more than... Okay, got it. Yep, just 13. So let's tackle these one at a time. H5. Well, that's ambitious. just tempted to switch through games here and try to pick something easier to start on. Yeah, this one looks ambitious. Let's come back to that in a minute. Let's start with an easier one. Like this here. Knight F3. Alright, so I had intended to play bishop b7. I have no reason not to play it unless I can, like, stop d4 from happening. Like, what's he planning to do? I'm not sure. Also, is my bishop going to a6 or to b7? That I don't know. If I play c5, he could play e3 and d4. So, if he plays d4, I have bishop a6 at my disposal. Let's just Queen's Indian this up. There we go. Simple. Okay, auto switch on. Get me a new game. H6. So I was intending bishop h4, and if g5, then bishop g3. Hang on. If g5, I need to take first on f6, and then retreat again. Is there anything wrong with that? No, but is that really what I want to do? Would I rather take f6 first and then go back to f4? If bishop d6, then maybe bishop e5. Well, this could be a boring endgame. I have to resign myself to the fact that this endgame could be less than inspiring. Oh, hang on, yeah, I'm going to transpose, like, if I'm considering lines involving this and black playing this anyway, and saying I'm not going to take that but retreat, then I should at least start here, not there, but here. Same idea, but I've provoked g5. I'm not afraid to provoke that, so this is where I want to go. Bishop g5. So I was expecting rook f5. So my analysis last time. This makes some good sense, too. Because this prevents me from castling. At this point, I'm thinking I need to bail out with rook f1. And try to get my king escaped out of here. Another possibility would just be bishop f3. Preparing the castle directly. I don't think I have other options here. I mean, I could exchange bishops and then queen d2. But then g2 hangs, and if I castle, he's got rook f2, and it's not pretty. So yeah, this exchange is off one of my best pieces. But I can't do much about that. What I could do is steal this bishop f3 and try to castle kingside now that my attempts to castle opposite sides have completely hit the fan. It's not working at all. Yeah, I think bishop f3 is my best way to go. If he does bishop f4 next, then we exchange bishops, I castle, and I can try to hold on to my pawn. Another candidate move is knight takes d5. It's a free pawn. Oh man. There's no such thing in life as a free pawn. Or a free lunch. Yay. Well, let's take a look at that. If I take. The obvious thing is if he recaptures, I recapture with check, and then I take the knight. That's the obvious part. What's not obvious is what about all the other lines? Can he move this bishop with tempo and I'm now in a pin somehow? Can he move this knight with tempo and then suddenly I'm not getting. Yeah, that's the deal. He gets to move the knight with tempo. And then I look silly. I mean, yeah, I can exchange bishops here. Oh, the knight's pinned, so it'd have to be queen takes, and then I take this. Then I take the bishop instead of hanging my queen. And he checks me, but I g3 and I'm okay. Or he plays rook d8, threatening queen d2 mate. I take this check. What do I do about this, though? Rook d1, maybe? Have I missed anything? There's probably somewhere earlier in this combination where things go awry. Like, probably bishop takes c1 right here. How do I counter that? I have to do this. This would all suggest, by the way, that my combination has to start with a different move. Like, I'd have to start with bishop takes bishop, and then take here. And I'm not sure what. Probably queen takes e5. And I've grabbed a pawn, but. Everything is hanging. So, that's not a free pawn. Another possibility is bishop a3, pinning the knight. That looks so ridiculous. That looks so ridiculous. He protects his knight, threatens bishop f2, among other things. This is disgusting. I don't want to go there. I don't think that leads anywhere good. Yeah, I think I just need to attempt to castle. And I'm certainly holding off black, and the only thing to worry about would be this, and this doesn't work. Like, he's got no way to break through this. As far as I see, let's have some fun with this. Go back to the game and get castled and just play a normal game. My e pawn hangs. I don't care. My e pawn might hang, his d pawn might hang. I'll be okay. This wasn't what I hoped for, but I've been too slow this game. So, there we go. All right, we got a Berlin defense. Excellent. Let me turn on the move noises. Queen c8. Well, I assume his idea is just to run this pawn forward. He's saying he doesn't need his queen defending d4 anymore. But my idea here was. To go harass this d pawn. That part of this idea was also that I want to play G4, G5, if I ever have time to do that. So, point of order here, if I play F4, if he plays C4, this isn't the biggest threat on the board, because he has a larger threat. But I'm able to meet his larger threat and renew my own threat and take away this escape square. So C4 is out of the question there, so you'd have to play like Bishop H4. And then I have time to play something like C4 myself. Not that that's my best move ever, but I have time for it if that's what I really want to do. But I think the threat of E5 would encourage him to... Oh, hang on. The threat of E5 encourages him to do something. Maybe even G6. Oh, but then this hangs. Threat of E5 means he's got to defend this pawn somehow, either through C5 or D8. And we've already seen if C5, then his bishop ends up over here. I do this anyway. Yes, he does get C4 in, but I can play here, and his bishop's trapped. So F4 is huge. Let's go back. I want to see where this goes. And I'm too lazy to calculate it, and this is just for Lee Chess rating points anyway, so here we go. Alright. We got a King's Gambit. We're going to decline it. Okay, B5. B5 is played. Note that Black can at any time play Knight D6, but that doesn't mean he has to start there. He can start with this instead. Let's see. Oh, man. I've played this stuff before. I should have taken the other knight. But this has the advantage of it's not in book. If you believe that's an advantage. So... can I play Knight G5? He plays G6. That's weird. I could start with D6. D6, he plays Rook B8 or C6. Something to meet the threat on his rook. Yeah, I don't want to allow him to play this so easily. But I can't stop him, can I? B5 is quite resourceful. So my candidate moves here are Knight G5, D6, Bishop G5, and just like normal developing moves. Imagine that. A normal developing move being played and being actually quite decent. And then if he ever puts his bishop on b7 or a6, this rook is well placed anyhow. It's just strange though. You would think that, well, my rooks belong ultimately on b1. And on e1. So it's strange to move the rook and develop it before the bishop gets developed, but that's just how this turned out. Now, if there were some tactical shot with knight g5, that would be the move to play, but I'm pretty sure there's nothing there. Now here we're moving pieces, so like if knight g5, g6, or f5, then if I go over here, I'm pinned. No. He plays h5. But as I'm looking at this, this probably means that f5 is better. Because now his H pawn can attack my pinned knight. So that shot doesn't work. The shots we've been looking at in other lines with Bishop G5 don't apply here because he has Queen E8. He's also got like F6, but this is the more instructive reason. Then this bishop's misplaced. And this knight protects all these squares here. So the next square my bishop could go to would be F4. And I'm not sure that's where I want my bishop. I'm not sure I want my bishop on F4. So, and yeah, the other thing that occurred to me was like A4. But I think that's easily countered, as I said, with knight d6, hitting my queen, and then he just takes on a4. Maybe it's not so simple. So if I play this, if he goes back, move my queen somewhere, let's say here. I do have a bishop h6 threat. This counters the threat. Yeah, I don't profit any from this. Like, this pawn's defended. I could pretend it's not, but it is defended. Is there anything else? I mean, yeah, there's no tactical shot to follow this up, right? If I play this, he goes after my center, which he's gonna do anyway. But yeah, a4 does not help me develop. Rook b1's better because, well, is it? It looks better because my rook's at least active, but it seems to be the same outcome. Right, and then here I could play this, but now he plays knight c4. So let's back up. Yeah, let's do this instead. And that's not a free pawn. That is very much not a free pawn. Because this knight and the queen defend this square. And yeah, obvious threat is obvious. This could be overlooked, though, several moves in advance. So yeah, rook b1. Now, why does that not work in the a4 line? Queen f6. I still have this bishop e3. Yeah, so it doesn't really matter whether my rook's on a1 or b1. It's still not a free pawn. I mean, he might play this. Okay, then we take. He takes, I don't know, like this to open the rook. Take, take, attack. Knight moves somewhere here. Knight's trapped. No, it's not. It's got this square. And then we take a pawn and shake hands. That seems okay. A4, knight d6, queen g4. And queen f6. I want to play bishop to e3. Queen g6. If that happens, we exchange queens, exchange material, and so forth. And the profit of playing a4 here was that I get to take the a pawn. So there is profit to it. Is there anything more in this line? So, like, suppose we exchange rooks. Now he develops, and he's hitting this. It's kind of awkward to defend. I think it's okay though. Well, no, I can't do rook c1 to defend this because e2 is a fork. So I'd need to go back like knight d2. to hold my pawn. And then he's got rook f4 to bear a second piece on that. Go back. And he's got a couple squares to move his rook to, but ultimately he can't keep the rook on the fourth rank. So the c-pawn is fine. Sure, add current variation. Looks good to me. YOLO. Okay, so we're playing a4, assuming we got that entire calculation correct. That'll be something if that was actually a good guess. There's no way that we're going to see that position. But it looked good. Also, that doing so many pre-moves or conditional moves in a row is risky. Because you could have, I could have overlooked something there. Alright, so we're going to do a Vienna with knight f6. Ah! Okay. So, yeah, I think the deal here is that as long as these squares are under lock and key, it's very difficult for black to advance on this. So, as long as I don't give up the b2 square for nothing, I'm doing fine here. I think I want to do queen d2, queen e3. Like I was saying, I think this is my idea. Don't even shift the queen over if I want to. Unfortunately, there's not other ways to develop here, but I think this is good. And it's just really difficult for him to bear tons of pressure on that square. Okay, so he does play g3 after all. I still haven't decided where to put my bishop. Although surely he's putting his on the long diagonal, so I should do the same? Unless bishop a6 is better. Bishop a6, he's going to play d3. Yeah, I have to wait for him to play... I want to make him delay d4 as long as possible. I could even throw in c5 here. Or bishop b4. Bishop b4 seems weird. Just gives up the bishop pair. But c5 seems okay. And then I can put my knight on c6, and I have a weak square in d6. Maybe I just play d5 right here. I mean, that's even stranger. I want to play d5 and c5 at the same turn. And that seems a little tricky. Can I play... Let's see, so he's delaying d4 as long as he can, because he knows I might play bishop a6. Which would target the c-pawn and force him to play b3 to defend it. So, since he keeps delaying d4, I could put this in place. He plays this, I do that. Yeah, we could see this potentially. And suddenly I have the hanging pawns instead of him. This is not a position I play very often. The other question in my mind was, could I get away with this? But I think this just inspires stuff I don't want to see. Like, I have to play knight takes here. Because if I were to play e takes, now he plays d4, and this is just really awkward. I've played b6, and now I can't even use this diagonal. So I'd have to play knight takes. And he just develops normally, and I look kind of weird here. Look more than a bit weird. I'm down on development. He could play. I don't know if he wants to. No. He probably doesn't want to play e4. But I don't want to take his knight. And my knight doesn't have very many good squares to go to. So, if I'm going to play c5 and d5, I have to start here. And we could see this. And then. Oh, wait. My d pawn's loose. My d pawn is very loose. This is awkward. So he's got to go somewhere. I do this. I'm pinned. Do I sack an exchange, maybe? And then bishop d7, hitting the bishop. This could be playable. Then he defends his knight, and I can't take the bishop, and I can't take the knight profitably. So, or is it going to be queen here? What do I do about this fork? Now he's attacking this. I get the sense that this is just BS, because if this worked, you would see this in books everywhere. I've not seen this before, so it really seems like it's one of my own imaginations that can't possibly work. Oh, what's this about knight b5? After I take and I'm pinned, I have this check. Now he's threatening a check and forking me and stuff, so this is complicated. So he could play that. And I don't have a good counter, because if I take b5, I lose my queen. Yeah, d4 just seems. I can't play d4 right here. But because I can't, that makes this all a gambit, because I've played b6. I'm just in an awkward tactical situation where white's developed better, and my shots just don't work. And if there were a way to make this work, it'd be knight takes knight. But I'm not seeing a solution here. There's this check here. Or I'd take that knight. But he's not compelled to immediately capture the rook. He could throw in some moves. Like, he could do this to stop me from checking him. My rook's still hanging, and he has a discovered check at his disposal. This unhangs the rook, but not really. Because that rook still goes. Okay. What else is there here? Yeah, if he plays his queen a4, if he plays his queen a4, I could pin his knight, but then he wins my rook this way. Okay, this is all to say that playing b6 and then trying to win by a tactic is just not a good idea. So knight c6 shows how loose my position is. What had me worried is that he's gonna play like knight e5 and my d pawn is loose too. So before I can afford to play knight C6. I have to do something about this weakness. Well, I'm sorry. No, my main point here was that if he takes, I must recapture. I can't just play D4 straight away. And once I do this, then we end up here. And this is just a typical queen pawn opening position. And I can always secure this with stuff and things happen. My knight on c6 still looks weird. How did my knight end up there? Oh. Yeah. I mean, knight c6 inspires pawn takes pawn, but he's gonna do pawn takes pawn eventually anyway. I don't need to inspire that. Instead, I could just play bishop e7. He plays knight e5. I play bishop e6. And hopefully, I'm not losing. He's got three. I've got three in there. He checks me. I can block. He forks me. I lose my castling privileges. I lose my bishop pair. Oh, so the point of knight c6 really is not to inspire capture, but to stop knight e5. So knight c6 is okay. I just can't play d4 next. I just need to recapture, and he castles, and we play a game. We had a bit of an adventure in the opening. I'm still underdeveloped compared to him, but I get out of this alive. C5. Bishop d2, d5. Wait, where are we? We're still over here? Is that so? Oh, yes, yeah, so I was debating do I want to play c5 here? I thought we had advanced further, but no, this is where we're at. Do I still want to play c5 to try to get some advantage out of this opening? Well, all those lines we were looking at, I had some mild disadvantage. Having difficulty holding this stuff together. And this idea of going c5 and d5 is contrary to this more reserved opening that we're doing. And in all the lines, I don't end up playing bishop up to d6 anyways, so there's no benefit to playing d5 early. C4 is going to be well defended in any event. I think I should just play bishop e7. This is ultimately where my bishop wants to go anyway. No need to go into all those razor sharp, complicated lines when I've got a simpler solution that works more consistently with what the rest of what I'm doing. All right, let's keep our bishop and prepare to play g6 there. Okay, now we're back to this one. So, do I play rook d1 or bishop e3 or what? A5? A5 looks fun. Problem is, how do I follow it up? That's a problem. That's a problem for sure. No, a5, and then I play bishop e3, and I can't actually land anything on b6 because that knight's on d7. Oh, right, so my last move was castle. I don't really think this h5 is threatening at all. If the pawn makes it to h3, I just play g3. And if he makes his next pawn to g4, I just play f4. So, there's really not a lot to fear from that. Actually, bishop g5 is now possible, and he can't kick my bishop anymore. But I could play h4 first, just to really fluster him. Not just that, but to anchor my bishop on g5. I don't understand h5 because it's way more optimistic than anything I would play at this time control. In Blitz, sure. In Bullet, yeah. In Correspondence, you gotta, I don't know. I can't criticize too much because I do play fun stuff in Correspondence, but I really don't see what this achieves. So I could play either H4 or A5. A5 is just really hard for him to do anything about. The one thing to watch out for is that I never hang my A pawn. But it does stop Queen B6. It does stop Knight B6. It does not stop Knight C5. But with this pawn on A5, I can then do more aggressive things. The pawn ending up on A5 is pretty typical in this kind of system, this kind of pawn structure. I'm just considering, do I have better? I don't think I do. Oh, if he ever plays h4, I just play h3 and then just round up the pawn with bishop g5. That's pretty simple. So yeah, I think a5 is the thematic move, and it makes a lot of sense in this position, so I don't have any reason to hold back from playing it. It extends the range of my rook, covers the b6 square, prepares an invasion via bishop d2 and knight b6. So I still haven't decided, is my bishop going to go to d2, to e3, or to g5. I'm still flexible in that regard. And it does not hurt me to be flexible. In fact, I don't necessarily have to play bishop d2. I could always consider consider b4 and then just dropping the knight in this way too. B4 is atypical. Like, as much as a5 is thematic, b4 I don't think is thematic, and it seems to make a weakness back here. A5 is easy to defend, but B4 is not as easy to defend. On the other hand, if he plays knight C5, then I'm strongly tempted to just push B4, even though I've not seen that sort of thing before. Alright, is it not my move on any game? I think that's the case. Yeah, we've caught up on all the correspondence games. So this is attacked. This is attacked. He's attacking d6. He's going to bring as much firepower as he can somewhere over here. What's he going to target? Either d6 or f6. I think those are the two things he's going to try to target. And they're both pretty close by. They're both pretty well defended. He might be intending bishop g5. I did calculate this before moving. And the point is that if he ends up going back, I can just play h6 and g5. h6 is defended, so there's no knight takes h6 tricks. So bishop g5 is not so great. Bishop f4, bearing more pressure, doesn't really do anything because I've already got d6 covered. You may be intending knight e4, but that's not supported at the moment. You'd need to bring, like, queen c2 first to support that, and then I could just pick it off. Meanwhile, what am I planning? Why did I ask? I don't know. So, yeah, I think this is my idea. He's probably going to counter that. But countering that leaves a weakness on e3. So the other idea would be that I'm going to play g6, bishop g7, knight g4, and bishop d4 check. And with my knight covering the e3 square, so there's no blocking on e3. I had a position like this in a tournament game years ago. And I did get outclassed because I think I was playing either an A player or an expert. Somewhere somebody who's rated over 1800. Though I could have sworn it they were over 2000 too, but I don't. Or they were over 1900. I don't remember if they were over 2000. But they're still really good. I just got outclassed, and the opponent happened to see these ideas of knight g4 and bishop d4 and such that I thought would never work. That seemed too speculative. But no, he was absolutely right, because he knew these sorts of positions and structures, and I was kind of winging it. So he knew where the danger lied, and he avoided the danger. Whereas, I saw a potential for an idea, but I didn't think it was a real idea. So, over here, yeah, I know where all the tricks and traps lie in this opening. So I know what things that I should be trying to avoid in general. But my opponent has the better position. Presently, I'm down a pawn, but I've got plenty of opportunities to try to recoup the pawn and or create havoc on the king's side if my opponent plays passively. So that's what's up there. Let's see, I've been responding to things in the forum. Let's pull up some training positions. Okay. I want there to be a checkmate over here somewhere. You would think that like queen g7 or queen g8 or something would lead somewhere, but I'm not seeing it. The other thing I want is like knight b5 to knight c7 to do something, but I don't think that does anything. I've seen this before. This is a silly puzzle. Yeah, so the idea is you're gonna try to mate on the dark squares. And black blocks said checkmate. Now your pawn's pinned, so you can't do pawn takes bishop. I forget what to do next. I want to say rook takes bishop because it's the most violent answer. But I wonder whether queen h5 is merited. Yeah, the Stockfish tends to prefer violent solutions because it's quite well, no, these puzzles in general tend to prefer violent solutions. Not so much Stockfish, although it'll find positions which have only one solution, and those are the ones that this generator uses, this puzzle generator. Like, if there's a position that has two possible solutions, that gets rejected from the puzzle pool. So I happen to know that you have to pick either rook takes bishop or queen h5. One of those is correct, one of those is wrong. And if I'm starting from the premise that one of these is wrong, sometimes that actually tells me something about the answer itself. Usually it means that the more violent answer is the correct one. Like in this case, rook takes g5 would be the most violent. Then you see knight takes, queen takes, and then rook f8 to stop queen f6, but then you have rook g1. It just feels like that's the most violent and that's got to work. Right. Whereas, say, if you were to play Queen H5, this probably wins material. But it's not threatening mate, is the point. So, yeah, both Queen H5 and Rook takes Bishop win material. Just happens that Rook takes G5 also keeps the mate threat going. Whereas Queen H5 only wins, like, a minor piece, if that. But I think it. So I don't like this puzzle because I think Queen H5 is also good. see this. Rook g5 is good. Queen h5 is equal because of rook takes f4. Oh, right, and there's a perpetual check or something. I've seen that before. I meant to get to that point, because I've seen this puzzle before. And yeah, queen h5 does threaten to win material, but it's not violent enough. And this, because the puzzle generator looks for puzzles which have only one valid solution, basically, unless you're giving checkmate, or unless there's some obvious reason other variations don't work, you're probably doing it wrong. So just winning a minor piece is usually wrong as opposed to giving mate. So I heard a notification go off, which means it's got to be my move. Let's go to my profile. Playing a game right now. Here's our game. Rook e8. Okay, so this avoids tricks with bishop h6 and then winning an exchange. So, can I get anything out of that? Like, what I'm looking at now is that he just trapped his queen. So I can consider things like bishop g5. And if he doesn't want to give up the rook, he could play f6. And I play bishop h6 anyway. So he stopped me from winning an exchange. I think he does develop. But for sure this isn't what he intended. For sure we're far outside of where he intended to go with this. And let's see. And then I could take here. I could lose my bishop, maybe. I'm not sure. Oh, wait. But maybe I want to first take over here. So you've got to do knight takes. And then I get my pawn back. He could take a pawn. He could also play d6. But I get all kinds of plays still. Stuff's going on here. There's always stuff. Now, you might ask why rook AE1. I'm just trying to avoid check silliness where I lose the tempo. Could well be that having my rook, moving my other rook to E1 might be more reasonable. And now, I mean, we still have this take, knight takes, pawn takes. He's still defending this, so he could play queen d5 again. This all transposes. And the idea is that, well, you know, he could defend his knight this way. But that doesn't matter because, this would be check and mate. or check and just winning a minor piece. Although, wait, no, this is to be avoided by black. So that says to me, that's just a sample variation, by the way. He could play other things like rook e7 here. Where I don't get this tempo move rook e1. Or suppose I do play this tempo move. He could take on e1 with tempo and play queen f8. And we end up in something similar, but here he's doing a lot better. Except for silly shots. A la Deep Blue. So he can't take my pawn. There's all kinds of poison here. So he doesn't want to take, because that gives me a tempo. I'm still threatening mate. And yeah, he could play like this here to force me to move away. I have to run, and he goes back. And I've collected my pawn. I'm doing okay. This is awkward. So, bishop g5. If he plays f6, we get all this stuff. The point of throwing in bishop g5 first, by the way, is that if I play this directly, I happen to know that this works for black. Just in general, as a blanket statement, this always works. So this is why bishop g5 is the most alluring thing here, is because that denies queen f6. He could play f5 though. But then he's not winning my queen or anything. Now he has to give up a rook, or a queen for a bishop. So I think this compels f6, but I don't think f6 helps him. And this compels like g6. Because of all the tactics we just observed. But I'm not sure I've got a follow-up to that. Like if I take here, oh no, I could hit this. I could hit it again and just keep hitting. And he goes back. Really, what I want is this a pawn. It's more comfortable for white. Could also just retreat here immediately and strike that. In which case he probably pushes it, maybe one, maybe two squares. So do I want to play bishop g5? Now that I see not just f6 but also g6. I don't have more pieces to add to this attack. So either I have to rule that succeeded or it's failed. And it's not looking successful. I have to kick, and I have to kick it again. I have to retreat somewhere. White's got pressure, but it's not enough to crack anything. Also, now he's got this at his disposal. Have to watch out for that. Although, supposing we do that here, his knight runs low on squares. Could always temporize like this because g5 is just insane. You don't want to do g5 here. So queen h4 is okay. This is all well and good. I think this is the best I'm gonna get. I think holding off from bishop g5 doesn't help me at all. Because he could still play queen f6 anyway. I'm curious why he didn't play queen f6 directly, why he didn't play f5 directly. This leaves me confused. Like, he has something in mind with rook e8. Either it's defensive or it's offensive, and I can't tell what. Also, I could just play bishop b2. If I do bishop b2, subtle threat. I guess he does knight c4. And I have to go back. And then he could play d6. So that's not so good. I could take directly. He does knight takes. And I do this. And he does this anyway. I think this is okay. As fun as it was to do those silly tactics, Black hasn't goofed up here, so if I'm hunting for a mate, I'm not gonna find one. So my last move was a4. His last move was knight. My last move was queen g4, and he played rook e8. So he's playing defensively, I think. Oh, a more active move than taking, which would just be just to develop here. Like we said in so many other lines, this is something that I might consider doing. Well, let's just do it directly. Yeah, so this indirectly attacks a7, and as well as g7. This solves the problem of where is my bishop going. Like, trying to fianchetto the bishop behind the pawn isn't so great. Putting it out here seems just fine. But this must be his point. So if I retreat, he plays this. Wait, why am I retreating? If I advance, he does this. I fork. He takes my queen. I take his queen. He takes my pawn. I get this. This is nothing special. If I retreat this way, this gains a tempo. Why am I doing bishop e3 first? What if I do a combination of my ideas, where I play bishop g5 first and then I play bishop e3? So I've provoked a weakness along this diagonal. But I can intend bishop d4, but that... Now I don't have any mating threats. That seems awkward. Still got this. He's still winning my a pawn. Well, if my bishop can't use that square because it can't get there fast enough, what about my knight? This is atypical for this opening, but we're out of book already. My knight's not doing much in terms of kingside attacking anyway, so why not play this? Now this fork no longer hits the a pawn. I could go back, and if he tries to attack me, well, he just loses his knight. I was going to say I have queen f3, but knight takes knight is better. He wants his rook on the open file, but this seems too generic. It doesn't seem to address the needs of this particular position. So, there's knight d4, there's also, if I'm doing bishop e3, I'm trying to harass this, but he defends it in time through the a-file. And if I do pawn takes pawn first, then we see knight takes. We probably see rook e4 first, because I don't have any way to gain a tempo on the rook. But if I'm doing pawn takes pawn, is it not better to do this first anyway? So do this, and then maybe throw in my original idea, which was... since I can't get my bishop to d4, throw in knight d4. My pieces are all active, and yeah, he could get this in, but... my pieces are better. than his are. Sure, I'm not threatening to take his pawn, but I've got stuff. I've got chances. Now let's go back to the game. I think this is what I want to do. For so many reasons. Okay, so he's preparing a retreat square for his bishop. Yeah, I never mentioned this aloud, but putting the knight in front of the pawn helps me a little bit. I didn't think he would do this. I was mistaken. So I don't have a good way to hit this knight. This is a question of which pawn storm goes through first. I'm pretty sure his is moving faster. But if I don't play g4, what am I doing here? Well, yeah, g4 is the move. Everything else creates too many weaknesses. We need to push with our strength. Which, admittedly, this position is a really slow, slow strength. So, okay, he plays that as suspected. We're going to play bishop h6 as prepared, as I had analyzed was good. They always say in correspondence chess, it's good to check your analyses before playing the moves. But I think we exhausted that last turn. Now, I assure you that for most of my correspondence chess, I don't do nearly that much analysis. And we saw how quickly I went through it, too. Okay. Just all those variations. We did tons of analysis. Very quickly got through a lot of ground. So, if I remember right, my point here was that after rook e1, I'm doing stuff with tempo and collecting the b-pawn. Right? I know my analysis isn't here at the moment, but I think the point was that rook e1, queen here, rook takes, knight takes, and that I could take on here. Well, this isn't exactly right. No, I'm not the one exchanging rooks. If he exchanges rooks, I'm fine. But then his knight's not there. See, my point was that white is fine here, and that knight takes b5 loses a rook. In this case, gets mated. So I've got the one tempo I need. So he's got to move his queen away. I don't want to take the rook. I just want to take on b5. And white's okay. It's the simple line. Now I'm trying to bust it, because I don't believe that my opponent would allow this so easily. I'm not sure. I am not sure. So f5, I take, knight takes is forced. Queen g5 seems to make the most, well actually, queen g3 hits the c7 pawn, so I could bring my bishop back to bear on that also. Queen g3 also leaves open like knight e5, knight g5 possibilities. Now granted, he could just take my d-pawn, and he's still up a pawn. Oh, right, this is the thing we analyzed, where I said this is actually a pretty serious threat that's hard to meet. It's a quiet move, this rook e1. And all of that, though, I didn't consider this. Because that hangs the knight. That's why I didn't consider it. Yeah. Actually, these lines were a take there. Move my queen, which is a quiet move. He takes my pawn. Move my rook, which is another quiet move. This all works out. Do I want to just commit to this? Because I'm feeling pretty confident in it. AB5. Oh, right. That raises a question if I'm going to go into that kind of line. I mean, rook fe1's the move. Queen f7. Do I want to do rook takes rook here, or do I want to allow him to rook takes rook? Because the line I've been looking here is ab5. Oh, if I do rook takes rook, that helps his defense. And then he can actually take there, right? Now, ab5 just wins the pawn as opposed to rook takes rook. If he takes my rook, that's a tempo for me. Whereas if I take, I'm not sure it even matters. I think it's useful though keeping his knight here in front of the pawn as long as possible so he doesn't have like a d6 discovery. The one concern is if I take, he's got f5, then I have to exchange. Do I? Yeah, I do, because otherwise you get some interesting attacks going. And right, my main point here is that this is not a free pawn. That because that's not a free pawn, I'm A-okay. He can do this with tempo. Can I counter that? Do I have a counter to that? This, then bishop b7, then I kind of have to move, but I'm pretty sure rook e1 is nonsense in any event. Okay, so this is another advantage of queen g3 over queen g5 is that this, after king h8, I'm not losing my bishop. It's not trapped. I can actually retreat. And he can take, and I can take, and he can take, and I'm not doing better, but I'm not too terrible here. The whole point of rook e1 is that if he takes here, I've got this check. He can block. Actually, he could block on f6. And he's not in any danger of getting mated. So, yeah, that doesn't work so well either. Rook e1's still my move, I think, but I have less confidence in it than I used to. Yeah, we'll see where this goes. Back to the game. Rook FE1 is my developing move. I don't think I'm going to good places there, though. All right. He's offering a couple things here. Note if I take this pawn, he takes my pawn. This is no good. I could take his knight, but I get mated. So that's kind of bad. I could exchange queens. So, queen takes queen, pawn takes queen, e5, and he's got this d pawn that's just floating out there, but I have no way to take advantage of it. Furthermore, my f pawn's kind of not where it wants to be. Oh, shoot. Yeah, my e pawn is loose here, So if I just move my queen somewhere, he takes my e-pawn. So basically this means my options are e5 or queen takes queen. Nothing else really meets both threats. He's threatening this and this. So if I just move the queen away to defend one of these two, he takes the other one. I could do queen d5 to confuse the matters. They think he just plays rook d8, and then I have to take his queen. So that doesn't help me. So if I take and then I play e5, that's okay. That certainly transforms the nature of this game. So what we're looking at is take, take, push, bishop e7. And then I could build more pressure on this d pawn. He could add another defender. I can add another attacker. I can add another defender. And it's pinned. And he attacks my knight. And I can't go to d4. But I could do this. He could take my knight. And I win the pawn. But I'm losing my pawn. Actually, yeah, this undermines my f pawn. So this is kind of critical. By kind of, I mean this is absolutely critical. He's got to take there because his rook's attacked, and I could take here. And we're still in equal position. I have a bad bishop to his good knight. Knights are always good. I'm pretty sure I can't do this here, right? Yeah, no, everything's hanging there. That's no good. So e5 seems like this is not working. F5 maybe. So the point is just giving up on trying to win this d pawn, at least for this instant. I'm just finding some squares for my stuff to be on. So if he considers this, he's blocking his bishop. He's not considering that seriously. He's probably instead considering taking here. I recapture. And he's got four pawns over here. One, two, three, four. I've got three pawns over here. The question is, like, which side develops first and smashes through and promotes and all that good stuff. If we go there. So e5 is just not good. F5 looks tempting, and if I don't do f5, he might play this. And then just pull his bishop back. So on the other hand, if I play this and he plays e5, it's harder for me to get my knight to, or it's not simple to get here. I'd have to instead reroute through c1. If I could. There we go. And that would allow me to hit this pawn, but I'm not sure where to put the rest of my pieces, but this still looks good. So, I think I should exchange queens, not that I have much choice. But even if I don't. Actually, yeah, that's a way to defend both. So I said this is all predicated on this double attack. I could meet the e4 pawn threat with knight g3. I didn't consider this. I'm not sure if he did either. And this just brings my knight closer to everything over here. I have to just give up on the idea of trying to win this d pawn, because my opponent's not going to hang it. I don't like taking, because he who captures first loses ground. I don't like. Well, suppose he takes. I don't like C takes because that gives him a protected pass pawn, but B or A takes has some demerits as well, because now he's able to crack this open ever so slightly faster. Yeah, no, it's probably best that I just fragment as pawns. Queens are exchanging here, because otherwise I'm losing my e-pawn. Like, the insanity that would result from this just isn't worth it in any sense. Yeah, there's nowhere to move this bishop to get my king to escape. So that's not an option. Queen d5 just loses everything a lot faster. Right? Queen d5, he just develops. That didn't do me any favors. Also, I suppose he doesn't develop. I don't know. It just looks terrible. Looks like I'm losing another pawn. Oh, hang on, this is where we started, though. Yeah, that's not an option there. This is cut off. So you'd have to go like knight b8 or knight d8 or something. And then this wins the d pawn. So, yeah, he's not taking on d5. He's gonna move his rook over. And then I take. Then we can do all this stuff, and he's got one less rook in this vicinity. One more rook behind his pawn here. I think that's okay. Could also consider knight here. Right. That's the same thing we were. Oh, no, I'm sorry. In all these lines. I'm sorry, this line. No, this line's still the same. Still the same old news. So queen d5 looks okay. On account of this exchange not hanging my d pawn. And everything just barely being covered. We got this. If I take, he takes. I take. This is okay. It's nothing special. It's playable. I have to go here. And I'm not sure what's going on. Oh, hang on. Can I throw in another move? No, he's going to play rook b8 when he feels like playing it, but he's going to play g6 first. But because of that, I can throw in g5 after these captures. He moves somewhere. I take. And then I attack stuff. He's got to exchange. And then he safely defends. And I'm one tempo too slow to do anything to hurt him. A single tempo. Like, if I could play rook e8 and bishop b4 or something, I'm not sure how that would even work, but in theory, an extra tempo would help a lot here. Like, if I could play f5 and get rook here immediately and then bishop c7, that'd be great. It's not what we're looking at. Can I be tricky somehow? Like, this tries to get a tempo over there. This defends the d pawn. This hangs my b pawn. There's no way this works. So let's go back. Right, now c pawn covers the b4 square, so again, I don't have any tricks. So This all suggests that why don't I just run? Now he wins my d pawn. I don't win his. No, I'm sorry, that doesn't win my d pawn. He's got to go retreat again somewhere. We hit the bishop. The bishop retreats, and then we hit this, and this is awkward, isn't it? He defends this pawn. We capture it. He captures back. He's not hanging anything, yet. Might have been. I'm not sure where his pieces should be at this point. So I'm not winning this. Like, if I try this, he goes there. I try this. He defends. I think I'm out of tricks. So, but no. I think Queen D5 is okay. Seems like there are a lot of tactics that result from this. So let's see where we go. Okay. Bishop E7. Right, so this renews the threat on my knight. Can I play bishop d3 here? The risk of bishop d3 is that my pieces all get active, but pieces start liquidating quickly too. What's the alternative? It's not knight g3. Knight c5 seems no good. I could exchange bishop for knight, just to get an imbalance here. Should not be a terrible thing to do. It's just that as things liquidate faster, I might want to have the bishop pair. I think bishop d3 is a good developing move. Bishop d3, knight takes knight, bishop takes bishop, queen takes, bishop takes knight. Also, they need to check for stupid stuff like this, this. Suppose he does something crazy. I escape, he escapes. As long as I'm not worse here, I can play this. Right, G2's not actually hanging here. Oh, unless I do that, then it hangs. I could just play bishop d6, and he cannot castle. And if he takes here, then his knight's trapped. So yeah, this bishop d3 is a-okay, as it should be. Like, I haven't done some colossal blunders, so this should be fine. Okay. So rook ad8. This slightly slows down his pushing through on the a file. He really wants me to take on e6, and I don't see a reason to say no anymore. So let's do this. I'm going to play f5 next. I'm going to assume he takes there. I'm going to recapture. Or push. Okay. Because I need my pawns on light squares for my dark squared bishop to be effective. That's the principle of play there. What position do we want to look at next? This one looks fun. All right, how long have we been going? maybe do this for another half hour and then wrap it up until it becomes time to do another thing. Oops, I lost my network connection, as I frequently do. Somehow, Windows gets confused by this whole tethering thing. Either that or my cable that I'm using to tether. I don't know. That's gotta be a software issue. But yeah, I think that'll do it. Since I've lost my network connection again, and I don't have any way to hook up to the internet without tethering, if the software won't let me tether, then there's not a whole lot I can do. I would set up a Wi-Fi hotspot, but that's not going to make a difference, because this computer doesn't have a Wi-Fi connection. Give me a minute. I'll see if I can tether this. Try this one more time. Nope. Looks like I'm stuck. Yeah, I don't know. Like, something's up with the OS and or the browser. I know certainly I'm not streaming at the moment. But you would think, you would imagine that certainly what I'm doing would be doable. I just got a simple tether going on where I can't connect my phone's data through my USB port on the computer, and it pretends that I'm hooked up over the internet. And the only fix I found for this disconnecting is to log out and log back in and or reboot the computer. Either case, that's going to end the stream. So, yeah, thanks for watching. I might end up playing some more moves offline and come back. And I'm sure these correspondence sessions just drag on. And I'm not sure how much you guys enjoy seeing them or not, because I'm recording this offline. I haven't had a chance to upload it yet. So, take care. I'll see you next time.